The second feature is number of engines. Now, number of engines, who will decide the number of engines on the airship? No, I am not talking about the type of the engine, I am talking about the number of engines. Whether you will have one engine or two engine or 10 engines, who will decide that? No, a designer, if you leave the designer a choice, he will always say one engine. But the regulatory bodies might come into picture, like they come into picture for even aircraft design, and they might say, sorry, more than so many passengers, you must have two, minimum two. Okay. So, typically passenger carrying airships have at least two engines for reliability point of view. If one fails, there is a second one available. It will be disastrous to have a passenger carrying airship with single engine, and for some reason the engine fails, then it will be very difficult to bring them down. It will be unsafe. So minimum two, but then somebody might say, no, why two, why not three, four, five, six? So what decides that? So more than two is what regulatory bodies tell you, but they don't say you should have seven or six or five. So what would you do as a designer? If they say not less than two, will you limit it to two? Or will you go for three?
So based on the specification specified, like the minimum is anyway two. Within two I can achieve this.
Correct. If I can manage to meet all requirements within two, I will not put a third one. But suppose my requirements are so stringent or so large that I am not able to get the required cruise speed with only two engines, you may have to have a third engine. This doesn't normally happen in airships because they are not supposed to fly very fast. The power consumption increases rapidly with the size, and with velocity it is V cube effect. So, if someone gives you a requirement of a Mach 0.9 airship, then the requirement is flawed. Okay? If you put a very big engine or a more powerful engine, it will also create more drag. You will not be able to overcome. So, in airship design, generally we never see a third engine, except when that third engine is meant for something else. What could that be? For? Someone said power lift. What is that?
There are rotorcraft, hybrid of rotorcraft and engine, so you have rotor component.
Yeah, yeah, but look, I will have a separate discussion on hybrid airships. Right now, this methodology is only and only for conventional airships. So, please don't bring in complicated airship geometries right now. Right now, it's simple conventional airship, single envelope, axisymmetric body. Okay, so therefore, we will not look at those considerations. So then, why would there be a third engine, if at all? For augmenting the yaw power and providing additional yaw control. How will third engine help? Where will you put it? If you have three engines, where will you put it? The third one, I mean.
In the rear part.
Why in the rear part? Why not the front part? There might be more moment arm in putting in the front. You don't know. That depends on where the other things are located. So, you can put it in the bow or in the stern. Both options have been tried by people. Okay. But if you put it in the front, the problem is then where do you attach the mast? The front of the airship is kind of reserved for ground attachment, kind of. But there have been experiments with engine in the front to give direct side force. Also, an engine in the front might also spoil the aerodynamics of the airship because it will be a large draggy body attached to the front portion. Most airships have an engine, third engine at the rear, because there is this fin available to mount it. In some cases, the fins are not load carrying. They are not that load carrying. They are flimsy. So directly on the envelope. So one very good experiment that was done is, I can remember two of them. One was done by a German airship made by researchers and students called as Lotte, L-O-T-T-E, in which there was a third engine mounted on the back directly on the envelope. Similarly, we have seen in our videos the Zeppelin NT airship, which has got a third engine on the back, which can also swivel. So in normal takeoff and landing mode, I think in the normal takeoff mode, it is actually giving thrust. But when you want to counter side winds or other forces, it can give you side force also by tilting it. So it's important everyone should study about the third engine on Zeppelin NT and explain to us how it works on the Moodle page. So this is the second Moodle request. I can only say request because it is up to you to put it or not. Okay. Some of you will do it because there are 10% marks for it. Some of you will do it because you are enjoying the course and you want us and yourself to learn more. Remember, when you put something on Moodle, everybody learns. I also learn. Right. So number of engines could be 2 or 3, never more than that. There are some airships which are having 4 engines. Because they want to get rid of the fin. So we are also making one such airship in Brazil or in association with people in Brazil, where there will be 2 in the front, 2 on the back on the gondola. So on the gondola we are putting 2 horizontal rods and mounting 4 engines. And then we are saying by controlling these 4 engines and their thrust vectoring, we can fly the airship without the fins. So a finless airship. Now one researcher from Canada, McGill University, there is one Professor Nahon. He has supervised a student for making a finless airship with four engines. So I will upload on Moodle page the paper written by this student about the finless airship. Okay, the next important parameter which the designer has to decide, not the user, is the envelope L by D ratio. Length to diameter ratio, not lift by drag ratio, but length to diameter ratio. So now let's see, from basic aerodynamic principles, do we have any information on what should be a good length to diameter ratio for a subsonic body of revolution? How much should be the L by D? Around 10 is true for low speed aircraft. That's what we use in fuselage design, 10, 11, 12. Okay. But if you make an inflatable body of revolution with L by D equal to 10, the first problem you will encounter is for a given volume, you will have large surface area. What is the problem with that? Weight of the envelope will go up. Yes, more surface area means more possibility of leakage, agreed. Because there will be more joints, longer joint lengths, more fabric, therefore more leakage. Then there will be higher drag. Remember, we are going at low speeds. You will have skin friction drag, and that will become large if you have larger skin. So in airships, it has been shown that the best L by D is of the order of 4.5 to 5. Okay. So never we see airships with L by D far, far more than this number. There are exceptions. For example, there are some airships like Zeppelin NT, which has got a very large L by D ratio. That is driven by requirements like, see, a Zeppelin NT is a semi-rigid airship. So there the weight of the structure inside is more important than the fabric. Fabric there is basically meant for only giving a covering to the structure and to the gas bags inside. So when we look at conventional non-rigid airships, and I must clarify that this methodology is also limited to only non-rigid airships. So for conventional non-rigid airships, L by D max, length to diameter max is 5, 4.5. Okay. Then balloon volume for trim. I hope you will recall we have had a discussion on this also, and we also had a question in your examination about how the balloonay can be used for providing trim. What is trim? Yes, what is trim? When is an airship or an aircraft set to be in a trimmed condition? When the net moment acting on it is zero. Correct. So it maintains its position and flies. Right. Because if there is unbalanced moment, it will respond to that moment and change its orientation. Correct. So let us say the airship is now trimmed at an angle of 3 degrees. Angle of attack of 3D, it is flying a 3D angle of attack. For some reason, maybe I feel that at 3 degree angle of attack, there is going to be very high drag. It is a high speed flight. Okay. Airships don't fly very fast, but when they fly at near their maximum speed, they are actually flying at their fastest, almost the fastest. So at that speed, you will have large amount of drag. So let's say the pilot wants to fly in such a way that the airship is trimmed at 1 degree, not 3.5 or 4 degrees. So what can the pilot do? How will you change the angle at which the airship gets trimmed? Yeah, one of them is CG control. That is tough. That is very tough. Because having a facility to move the mass, yeah, inside you might say, okay, the gondola has got two fuel tanks, one in the front and one in the back, or there are two tanks carrying ballast of water and you pump, but it's complicated. Any other simpler way? Correct. You have two balloonay, and you can see, you want a particular amount of air in the balloonay to take care of the operating conditions, but you could get that from only the rear balloonay, only the front balloonay, or a mixture of both. So by adjusting, now the question is that in a way the balloonay volume that you carry is like subtracting from the volume available for the envelope. So what factor or what operating requirement directly decides the balloonay volume with respect to the envelope volume or the inflation fraction?
Delta H,
not H, very important, is delta H. From which height you want to go to which height, that is important. So if you are given some delta H from operating requirements, you will have to have, let's say, 30% balloonay you have to take, because delta H requires it. Now, you want to put additional balloonay for trim control, because 30% will be consumed in maintaining delta H requirement. But let's say at the maximum altitude or the pressure altitude when balloonay is flush, now you cannot use it for any trimming. So I would like to have some margin in the balloonay for pure trimming purposes. So, should that be 10%, 2%, 5%, how will you find it? So, this question was in front of us, that fine, we can calculate the balloonay volume required or the inflation fraction needed from operating requirements by using the aerostatic formulae, but how much extra to give so that we can have sufficient reserve balloonay volume for trimming purposes? How would you go ahead if you are given this problem? So how much is sufficient? Is it 5%? Is it 10%? Is it 1%? So Pratik, what would you do if you are designing an airship and you are facing this problem? Okay, let me put the problem in some other way. Okay, every month a student in IIT Bombay incurs some expenditure in accommodation, food, mobile, travel, blah, 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 blah. There is some number. Okay. But you have to keep slightly more than that for some emergency. How do you decide this number? Let's say you have landed up in IIT Bombay and you want to know what should be the monthly amount of money in my bank account so that I can take care of my expenses. So somebody will say, no problem, mess bill is, accommodation is 1100 rupees per month, mess bill is roughly so much, this is roughly so much, etc., etc. And then what do you do? Tell me, what do you do exactly? So you ask the seniors, right? You ask the hostel mates. How much do you spend in canteen? Typically so much. How much on mobile? Oh, don't worry, network is available here and there. Once in a while you need on the phone. So you can take a 1 GB pack. You know, like that, somebody will advise you. Similarly, we did the same thing. We looked at the data of existing airships. How much trim volume are they keeping? And we said, first thing is we should know how much they are keeping so that we don't keep less than that. And secondly, we said, let us see, if you keep more than that, what is the effect? So that we know, oh, we can't go more than what they keep because it affects a lot. This is what is empirical. Nothing wrong in this. Many people have a wrong notion that, oh, empirical means not non-technical. Empirical means all angutha chhap type things. It's not true. In fact, doing analytical calculations is very easy. No brainer. Because somebody gives you a method and you just punch those numbers and get some answer. That is very easy. That I think many people can do. Okay? The most challenging thing is to be able to get this kind of a feel of real life situation in design by learning from other people's experience, learning from what has been done, not blindly following it. Suppose SFC of a typical engine is so much. I don't say SFC is so much. I would say today's number is so much. 10 years later, intelligently, I have to find a way of predicting what will be the reduction in the SFC. Okay. We all do it, right? All of you. Sandeep has designed an aircraft and flown it. He never knew in the beginning what it would weigh. But he knew that typical UAVs are of this weight class. So now when he talks about it to other junior students, you can make out that that experience has come. Ah, you should do this, you should not do this. No one taught him unless he did it. So similarly, the designers who learn about things, they learn it only by experience, only by doing the calculations. Okay. So ballooner volume for trim, we decided this number, as I said, based on data of existing airships and a sensitivity analysis using equations on how much is the payload loss because of providing larger ballooner trim. The next point is internal overpressure. We all know that the pressure inside has to be kept more than the pressure outside, otherwise it will cave inside. But how much more? So that depends on many things. It depends actually on three things. It depends on how much dynamic pressure you are expected to encounter during flight. So if you are told at this speed, at this altitude, just calculate half rho V square, that will be acting on it. And it should be, pressure inside should be atmospheric plus more than that. That much more than that, so that it does not cave inside. But then there are other things. In a very large airship, even the pressure will be different at the bottom of the envelope and top of the envelope because of the weight of the gas acting on the bottom. So when we look at stress analysis, that will be a chapter in one of our studies, we will look at these three factors. What we did is, we are starting the design, we don't have all this data. So we took an internal overpressure based on the information available about other airships. So the configuration parameters are some things that the designer assumes either based on experience or based on, okay, we will try cross fin and then see plus fin and then take the best of the two. The performance requirements are given by the user and also the operational parameters.